Oh, I want to go on that beach, don't you? Beautiful images from Africa this morning, tropical climates unlike our own, and beautiful words that speak of God's love for families despite the mistakes that happen, the craziness we know in our own lives, and God loves us still. What a beautiful way to begin worship here. Trinity and Anjou United Churches, a very warm welcome to all this morning as we worship. A few announcements to make. We are so thrilled that it is February once again. Maybe not our favorite weather month, but we love Black History Month. And so we'll have opportunities over the next number of weeks to gather both in worship and out of worship to celebrate aspects of Black culture and Black history, including two opportunities. Many of you know the actress Cicely Tyson, who just died at, I think, the age of 91. A groundbreaking actress in both movies and TV. And I thought we might share some of her best-known films as part of a Cicely Tyson tribute. So later this month, after worship, those that would like to will come back on the Zoom link to watch her movie Sounder and the autobiography of Miss Jane Pittman. So I hope you'll look forward to those opportunities. We may have surprises in store for you, as well as music and story. So we look forward to a rich celebration together. Also, you might have seen the announcement that our Pride Fellowship is offering a book study over the next number of weeks, looking at a book called Transformation, the Bible and Lives of Transgender Christians. We'll be starting that next Saturday in the afternoon, and books can be easily ordered for Kindle or one-day delivery. Isn't this the world we live in now? Amazon Prime. And so if you're interested in learning, meeting through a book and in discussion, transgender Christians and how the Bible relates, we would love to have you. A number have already signed up, but please do see me if you are interested in that, and we can help you order a book or in any way that we can help you. So wonderful opportunity coming up, and it is in the weekly email for more details. We have just heard that our friend Judy Massarelli, unfortunately, is in hospital this morning, and our prayers go out to her and Philip and Dorothy and the whole family, because we are concerned for her always. So we pray that her stay will be a short one, and she can be back home at her residence very quickly. Also, we're keeping in prayer, just learned this morning of a friend of Margarita Issa, who a Filipina friend who has a sister in the Philippines, just went through brain surgery and hasn't woken up yet. And so I hope we can keep that sister in our prayers throughout this morning's service for healing indeed. Having done our announcements, I'm glad that Gary is here with me in the service. Many of you know that our dear friend Milton Thompson has died in the past week or so. Martha Nell and the family will be coming to this sanctuary this afternoon for 2 o'clock for a celebration of life service for Milton. The Reverend Rosemary Lambie will be here to preside at that service as a wonderful, very close, and longtime family friend. So we look forward to having Gary here and Julia for some music and celebrating that life that is so important to many of us. So if you know Milton and would like to be a part of that, it will be on our usual Zoom link starting at 2. So with that, I'll invite Aaron to begin our keynote for this morning. And we have a hymn, I think, all of us. I love to tell the story, number 343, if you have a hymnal, and we'll be doing verses 1 and 2.
Stories, giving blessings. It's what we do as followers of Christ.
God's love for us is reckless, too wonderful. How can we even believe it?
People of story, being a blessing, it's what God's people are called to be.
All praise to you, O great God, as you guide us into life. And invite Michelle and Robin to unmute to lead us in our unison prayer of approach and Lord's Prayer.
Prayer of approach. Great guiding one, thank you for bringing us to worship this morning. Thank you for this community. Friends, old and friends, we're just meeting right here on Zoom. Bénissez-nous dans nos maisons et sur nos écrans. Amenez-nous en communion les uns avec les autres et avec toi. You deserve our every praise this day, in this hour and always. Amen.
Amen. Let's join together as we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you so much, Michelle and Robin, and Aaron and Gary, for that exuberant call to worship. Thank you very, very much indeed. Wow, look at those camels in the snow. I've never seen such a sight. Beautiful indeed. We're not talking about camels in the snow, however, this morning for our young people, although that gets my imagination going for sure. What we're talking about this morning is, can you guess what it is? God's love for you. Surprise! No surprise. Of course, God loves all of us, all of the time. And that seems impossible because we know, don't we, that we make mistakes. We say mean things sometimes. We turn our back on a friend in the playground, when we're together in the playground, that is, when we should include that person in our play. We know that our young human lives and our older human lives, we're not perfect people. And in the old days, we might have thought, kids, I'm telling you it's true, that you had to be perfect to be worthy of having God's love. When in fact, the message of Jesus in his teaching is almost the exact opposite, that God wants us to be fully human, and that means our mistakes too, and that God is going to love us all the way through, unconditionally. Unconditionally. It's amazing. We got to be exuberant because of how wonderful God's love is. And I think you're going to be hearing a little bit in your Sunday time with Sherry about how God's family, even in ancient times, was so loved, despite being pretty crazy. We've been hearing over these past few weeks, haven't we, about Isaac and then Jacob, and we heard Joseph's story last week, going all the way back, and you've heard these names before, and Sarah, you're going to like one of these names, Abraham and Sarah. They are like the great, 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 great grandparents of all of us. And God decided, God liked these two people and was going to make a big family out of their family. And so they had kids and their kids had kids coming all the way down through the Jewish people to we who are a part of the Jewish Christian tradition. And we've heard how imperfect some of Abraham and Sarah's kids turned out to be. Remember that, all the scheming and who's going to get the blessing and, oh my goodness, big fights. And we don't think that this is what God wants. And I don't think God wants that for us. You're hearing it from me. Don't try this at home. But despite all of it, God loves all of Abraham and Sarah's children, all of Isaac's children, all of Jacob's children. 12 sons he had, 12 sons. Joseph, we heard his story last week. But all of them, despite some going down difficult paths and some doing very well in life, God stays with and loves each one. So there's a song that I love to sing when we're talking about the way that God loves, which is generous. God just gives God's love away as if it was only worth a penny. We don't even have pennies in Canada anymore. Wow, what about that? But some of you know this song. We're going to sing about the magic penny, about how love is just something that you can give away and you end up wanting more. Let's sing that at home together. Now we want this one.
Love is something if you give it away, give it away, give it away. Love is something if you give something if you give it away. Give it away, give it away. Love is something if you give it away. You end up having more. So let's go dance until the break of day. And if there's a piper, we can pay. 'Cause love is something if you give it away. You end up having more. Is something if you give it away, give it away, give it away. Love is something if you give it away, you end up having more. Money's dandy and we like to use it, but love is better if you don't refuse it. It's a treasure and you'll never lose it unless you lock the door. Love is something. If you give it away, give it away, give it away. Love is something. If you give it away, you end up having more.
Yeah, that's what we like. We want to give our love away because our God in Christ gives his love away to us each and every day. What a great message for all of our families and for each one of us. Kids, I know you're going to have a great time with Sherry. We're going to let you go now, and we will hope to you'll pop in later so we can say more greetings to you. God bless you. And we'll invite Aaron to begin our hymn. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, guide-moi, berger fidèle, verses 2 and 4 in French. For those with a hymnal, it's number 651. Hymn to share this morning. Well, dear friends, we continue in the season of Epiphany, and as always, God sends light and love pouring down upon us, but too often we turn away. Too often we prefer the shadows that are familiar to the heaven that might just be awaiting us on the other side of making a change in our lives. when we could, with God's help, give up harmful patterns and habits, let go of grudges and resentment, practice forgiveness when we feel wronged by others, practice hope when the world as it is may want to drive you to despair. Thank God, God gives us the power to choose a new direction. In the prayer time to come, may the God we know in Christ come to you and give you that power to decide, to choose, to let go, to become the new person God is calling you to be. Let us be in prayer. O Lord, you know us through and through. Hear us now as we let go of all of our troubles, entrusting them to you, that we might be free. Hear us. O God, for your love, which is unconditional, for your grace, which is our truest reality, for your patience and forgiveness that knows no end, we give you thanks this day. Amen. I would invite Christine and Beverly to unmute to offer these scriptures to us this morning.
Ever heard of a deathbed blessing before? In the ancient world, it was a common part of life to listen for the wisdom of a dying elder. Words that could comfort and bless. Or, in the case of Jacob's words to his sons, we hear today, bless or curse. Let's listen now to a poem from the time of King David that imagines a father's thoughts on not only his 12 sons, but the 12 tribes that bore their names. A reading from Genesis chapter 49, verses 1 through 28.
Jacob called his sons and said, "Gather around. I want to tell you what you can expect in the days to come."
Come together. Listen, sons of Jacob. Listen to Israel, your father.
Reuben, you're my firstborn, my strength, first proof of my manhood. At the top in honor and at the top in power. But like a bucket of water spilled, you will be at the top no more, because you climbed into your father's marriage bed, mounting the coach, and you defiled it.
Simeon and Levi are two of a kind, ready to fight at the drop of a hat. I don't want anything to do with their vendettas, want no part in their bitter feuds. They kill men in fits of temper, slash oxen on a whim, a curse on their uncontrolled anger, on their indiscriminate wrath. I'll throw them out with the trash. I'll shred and scatter them like confetti throughout Israel.
You, Judah, your brothers will praise you. Your fingers on your enemy's throat while your brothers honor you. You're a lion cub, Judah. Home fresh from the kill, my son. Look at him, crouched like a lion, king of beasts. Who dares mess with him? The scepter shall not leave Judah. He'll keep a firm grip on the command staff until the ultimate ruler comes and the nations obey him. He'll tie up his donkey to the grapevine his purebred prize to a sturdy branch. He will wash his shirt in wine and his cloak in the blood of grapes. His eyes will be darker than wine, his teeth whiter than milk.
Zebulun settles down on the seashore. He's a safe harbor for ships right alongside Sidon.
Issachar is one tough donkey crouching between the corrals. When he saw how good the place was, how pleasant the country, he gave up his freedom and went to work as a slave.
Dan will handle matters of justice for his people. He will hold his own just fine among the tribes of Israel. Dan is only a small snake in the grass, a lethal serpent in ambush by the road when he strikes a horse in the heel and brings its huge rider crashing down.
I wait in hope of your salvation, God.
Gad will be attacked by bandits, but he will trip them up.
Asher will become famous for rich foods, candies, and sweets fit for kings.
Naphtali is a deer running free that gives birth to lovely fawns.
Jacob is a wild donkey. A wild donkey by a spring, spirited donkeys on a hill. The archers with malice attack, shooting their hate-tipped arrows, but he held steady under fire, his bow firm, his arms limber, with the backing of the champion of Jacob, the shepherd, the rock of Israel. The God of our fathers, may he help you. And may the strong God, may he give you the blessings, his blessings, tumbling out of the skies, bursting up from the earth, blessings of breath of beasts and womb. May the blessings of your father exceed the blessings of the ancient mountains, surpass the delights of the eternal hills. May they rest on the head of Joseph, on the brow of the one consecrated among his brothers.
Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. All morning he gorges on his kill. At evening divides up what's left over.
All these are the tribes of Israel, the 12 tribes. And this is what their father said to them as he blessed them, blessing each one with his own special farewell blessing.
Friends, this is a story of Judaism that continues to shape our Christian story.
May we find wisdom for our living. Best described as a Christian wisdom sermon, the book of James provides advice on how one is to live in the way of Jesus, which in the case of James also means a life rich in the wisdom tradition of Judaism. As believers in Christ began to feel alien from the world around them, their kinship with Jewish brothers and sisters became more heartfelt. Just as the Jews had been dispersed throughout the world after the destruction of the temple in 70 CE, so did Christians need to learn to live with trial and struggle, yet keep the faith. Let's listen now to the author's words of greeting to his readers from the book of James, chapter 1, verses 1 to 4.
I, James, am a slave of God and the Master Jesus, writing to the 12 tribes scattered to kingdom come. Hello. Consider it a sheer gift. Friends, When tests and challenges come at you from all sides, you know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way.
This is a witness to an early Christian community.
May we find wisdom
for our living.
Thank you so much, Christine and Beverly, for those readings and the words shared with us this morning. Friends, let us be in prayer together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be a witness, O God, to your way of love, justice, and faithful walking with us. Amen.
Amen.
His own special farewell blessing. Did you hear right? That's how the message describes Jacob, and we remember Jacob's name changed to Israel, how we remember Israel's deathbed blessings to his sons are described, each the namesake for one of the famous 12 tribes of Israel. Can you imagine, thinking back, having 12 sons whose lives are clearly all over the map like that? Like Reuben, the eldest, who starts off strong, but then finishes last, caught in some kind of sexual impropriety of the sort that disqualifies him from heading the house of Jacob in the future. Then we heard about intemperate Simeon and Levi, whose anger and violent rage uncontrolled between themselves and others. No thanks. Or there's Judah and Zebulun, who fare better in their father's eyes. Judah is like a lion, we hear, strong until a mysterious ultimate ruler will come, at which time Judah will tie his donkey to a grapevine, we hear, I guess to retire in style. While Zebulun settles by the sea and reaps the profits of a good harbor for ships. Meanwhile, Issachar, he lacks ambition and ends up as a slave of others. Dan metes out justice between his brothers and is well regarded for it. Gad, Asher, Naphtali, all are viewed favorably for their unique gifts. And Joseph, well, we should not be surprised that he gets a rave review, blessings tumbling out of the skies for him, the one who is consecrated among his brothers. Finally, Benjamin, the youngest, is deemed successful at satisfying his appetites, having plenty to divide up, to store and share. It's a special family, all right, special, if a bit dysfunctional, special and imperfect, special and blessed. If we take the idea of this story literally and imagine Israel, Jacob on his deathbed, whispering his goodbyes to his beloved sons, we can only imagine the curses and or the gloating, right, of each son upon hearing their father's words. For the sons who come up short, how can Israel's words of judgment possibly be considered a blessing? And for the sons who come out smelling like roses, what responsibility might they still owe to their less fortunate brothers? Is this a story of every man for himself? Or are they, and by inheritance through the Judeo-Christian story, are we somehow all in this together? It's a critical question for ancient Israel, beset, as we know, on all sides by empires and enemies, all too willing to just swoop in and take all of the spoils. It happens again and again in their thousands of years of history. It's a critical question for our nation states today, too. The USA is one case in point. Can Democrats and Republicans decide to get along and to cooperate to make that great nation work again? How about an increasingly diverse French public or the German state, when both of those societies seek to incorporate, if not also assimilate, important Muslim and African communities? How about we Canadians, we who are perhaps ever awakening to the privilege of the white European majority who have defined the politics and economy of this nation for so long, largely going unchallenged, perhaps until the last 50 or so years? Now, when Indigenous peoples are asserting their prior sovereignty to colonization and demanding in fairness, that their rights be recognized. Now, when Black and Brown sisters and brothers, citizens, migrants, refugee claimants, struggle against systemic racism for the full recognition of their inherent dignity and equality in the human enterprise that is Canada. Dysfunctional though we have discovered Israel's family to be, it is also true that God has chosen them to be God's holy people. And as large and rather unruly that family is by blood, it seems clear to me, at least, that they are stuck with each other. In ancient times, they needed each other to defend themselves, to trade among themselves, to be God's people together, because if they didn't band together, their identity, their land, their future would be swiftly taken away by others. For Canada, I don't believe the enemy we face is foreign to us. The enemy for us is lest we miss the opportunity being given to us in our generation to recognize each other across our differences as perhaps diverse tribes seeking to become one people. Canada's strength is in the opportunity we create and the meaning that we inspire together as we confront a past that can no longer hold all that we are called to be in the future. Like Israel's sons, our destiny lies in learning to appreciate each other under the guise of the one God we call by many names. Israel blessed each of his sons, we are told, giving each a special farewell blessing. Be it a curse that tells a hard truth about some tribes, under God's all-loving gaze, remember that? Perhaps telling a hard truth is really more of a blessing than it is a curse. They and we all need to be open to honest judgment, especially those of us with more power and privilege, so that we all can achieve a greater, fairer society. Now, the New Testament author James gives good advice to the Christians he addresses in the letter we heard just a few verses of a moment ago. When tests and challenges come at you from all sides, he writes, don't try to get out of it prematurely. Be open to the challenge. Let it do its work. So, I quote, you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. Perhaps God puts us all in challenging circumstances, changing times, because God knows to do so is a gift, not a curse. In being willing to honestly examine ourselves and our place in the nation we call Canada, we become a blessing to each other, not a curse. As we seek a more just future for not just some, but all the people who call this land home. And already we are seeing the results in more just laws, more recognition of minority rights hard won by the long struggle of people of African, Asian, and Indigenous descent. But there is still a long, long way to go. One thing is for sure, we can count on a blessing from God when we stick together on the hard road of becoming one diverse and just people. Doing so doesn't mean that we'll all end up the same. We can continue to assert and be proud of the differences of creed and culture, of faith, that form a human mosaic like the world has rarely seen. We can do this because of the ideals we hold high and those that God asserts, that God commands, as we seek to be his or her sovereign and just peoples. This God deserves all of our praise as we call on God to help us, the Christ we call on to heal us, the Spirit we call to strengthen us for the struggles ahead that will test us and will show us who and whose we truly are. May we be up for that opportunity. May we be ready to meet that challenge. Amen. Amen and amen. Our hymn is a different one today, folks. We're going to be singing along with Pastor Hezekiah Walker and his flash mob, wonderful choir and dancers. The words are in your bulletin. The words will be on the screen. This is a praise song. There's quite a bit of repetition. And I hope as we catch this spirit of of a great God that forgives and loves each one of us unconditionally, we'll all want to get up and dance and sing along. Let's be in this song now.
Every praise
is to our God.
I don't care how you're feeling right now. Sing hallelujah.
Oh my goodness, are you still with me there, everybody? Yeah. Every praise to our wonderful God in Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Wouldn't you just love to be dancing out there on that nice, what do you think, California street there in the sunshine and the warmth? We're going to get there. Let's have a flash mob this summer. Amen. So friends, God blesses us to become one people of praise as we acknowledge all the blessings God gives and as we share. By mailing our weekly envelopes, by donating through Canada Helps via Trinity's website, by e-transfer, or by pre-authorized remittance direct from our bank accounts, we sustain these communities of faith, the faith communities we love and that we need. We also contribute to God's mission to unite and to heal the world through mission and service. Let us give now as we are able. And as we do, we will listen to, we've heard this wonderful song, The Blessing, before. This time it comes to us from Christian artists all over the Caribbean. Let us enjoy this as we give.
To the islands of the sea.
Welcome to the island.
Come from Caribbean.
Make a space to shine upon.
Oh, we're seeing a cat dancing at home with David and Gary and Diane and Dolores. How wonderful. Amen and amen. Oh, I just want to go to the Caribbean right now. Amen. Let us be in prayer. Oh God, thank you. Thank you for the call to give what we might share, that we share who we are and who you are. Bless these gifts and we the givers, that we and your world may be transformed. Amen. And we join our hearts again in prayer. Gracious God, we come before you this morning as a blessed and blessing people, grateful to be alive, grateful to be part of this, our communities of faith, grateful to know you and to love you. Where can we look, O God, and not see you? What can we hear and taste and touch and smell and not be awed by our senses of the miracles all around us in the natural world? For the gifts you bless us with each day, God, we offer our thanks and praise. Wise and compassionate one, you call us out of ourselves to serve others. And we pray this morning for all the ministries we engage in every day. When we are friends to one another, we are a friend to you. When we raise children or create families of friends, neighbors, and strangers, even virtually here on Zoom, we become part of your family. When we make a living, and yet are generous with our time and money so that others may have health and life, we model the good stewardship of resources that make for your justice and peace. Help us claim all that we do as a ministry in your name, even as we become neighbor, advocate, and friend to all. Listening and caring God, we ask your help with the great and small issues that are before us, our communities, our nations. Be the wisdom of all people who seek to right past injustice so that all may live in harmony with each other and with this land that supports us all. Inspire our leaders to listen, to discern, to take bold positions that challenge the status quo, that we might discover our best selves, we pray. Healing God, your care for us goes deeper than any physician on earth. Bring your healing touch to those who live with disease, those who are recovering from surgery or may be facing surgery, those who are in hospital even this day. Be with those who live apart from loved ones due to age or incapacitating illness or this ongoing pandemic. Be with our caregivers, all who are in the front lines keeping people alive, keeping us safe. Hear now the prayers that we speak aloud or in the silence, and in your love, pray, answer, hear us. Oh God, we ask your special healing touch for Leika's sister in the Philippines who has had brain tumor surgery. Oh God, the tumor is out, but she has not yet woken up. May your healing hands be with her, her physicians, those who are watching and waiting. And may they be with Laika, who is so far from home, and that we know that is so hard for her. Bless her and that family, O God, at this time of waiting and watching. Keep our beloved friend, Judy, in your constant care at the Jewish General. We await word, and may she get better very soon, O Lord. For so many names on our prayer list, dear ones that we take into the week and pray for and with, we ask your blessings for health and for guidance and strength in all of the challenges and struggles they and we know. Thank you for hearing our prayers, for answering in your way and time, for giving us light for the shadow places we know. We give you thanks and praise. Amen. Our final hymn, number 634, if you have a hymnal, to Abraham and Sarah, let us sing. Out of the family of Sarah and Abraham, we too take our place among the generations of God's diverse, imperfect, yet striving and hopeful people. Let us rise to the responsibility God gives. Let us serve, be wise, as Christ and always serves all. Amen. We have a new seasonal commissioning song. Let us sing.
The kingdom
We are exuberant indeed this morning. Thank you everyone for joining us for worship this special Sunday. We are glad you are all here with us. And if you can stay, we have just a little more music to share and a musical pause that we'll have a time of fellowship just following. So if you need to leave now, we go with our blessing. May God be with you. Perhaps we'll see some of you back at 2 o'clock for Milton Thompson's very special celebration of life. God bless you all. So Aaron, I think this is on my screen. All right.
That you can't carry.
that's so beautiful. I don't know what that is, but...